everyone. Let's talk about sharding. So I guess I was already introduced. The only thing missing is that 2 days ago, you might have seen me at Epicenter at ETH hackathon, where me and Vlad, we built a POC of his sharding. And we were one of the 10 finalists. Let me give you a slightly better introduction to what Near Protocol is. It is a sharded proof of stake public chain. We make a very heavy emphasis on user and developer experience. If any of you ever coded on Solidity, that's exactly what we're not going to do. And then we have a team, the entire team is coming from the industry. We have 3 early MemSQL engineers, people who build sharding and distributed transactions at MemSQL. We have 3 ex-Googlers. And among us, we have 4 ICPC gold medals, which is ICPC is a competitive programming championship held every year. And since quite a few of us at Near were building databases in the past, that would be only reasonable if we start by walking through how databases are sharded today and how that can be applied to blockchain. So let's go back to 2004. In 2004, if you want to launch any service, it could be social network, online game, what have you, almost certainly you will just have a single instance MySQL or Postgre, and that will be your entire database layer. You will be making backups every couple days. If something goes wrong, you just recover from a backup, it's all fine. And it all works until you actually have users. Once you have users, it doesn't scale anymore, and then you start fixing it. The first thing you will do, you're probably gonna deploy Memcached in front of your database, which requires you to make quite a few changes to your application layer, face caching validation and all issues like that. When that doesn't help anymore, you will change some knobs, you will buy a significantly more expensive server. At some point when that doesn't help anymore, then you have nothing else left, then to shard your database manually. The question is, why do all of that instead of just developing a working sharded database which will just fix it all for you? And the answer is, it's way easier to build a cache, it's way easier to do all of those, let's call them layer 2 solutions, than actually to build something that works out of the box and distributes data. And let's see why. The problem number 1 is reaching a consensus. In databases, unlike blockchains, there is no malicious actors. If you have a cluster of 200 nodes, not a single node is trying to compromise the database. The only malicious behavior which exists in distributed databases is going offline. So every node at any moment can crash and go offline. And so we need to reach a consensus in a significantly simpler environment than blockchain on what data is actual and which nodes are online. And yet, as of 2018, majority of existing distributed databases lose data under stress. There's an entire blog about it called Jepson, where they run the same stress test, which doesn't change from experiment to experiment over different distributed databases, and each and every one of them loses data. So there are 2 lessons from it. Lesson number 1, it's actually, despite 20 years of research, it's still super hard to build consensus even in the absence of adversarial behavior. And lesson number 2, and I guess what is important also, is that in all the distributed databases, it is never the case that all 200 nodes, if you have a 200-node cluster, try to reach a consensus. It is always a small subset of them, between 2 and 10, that reach consensus on the state, and the remaining ones are all single box databases, which don't even know often about the existence of the cluster. And so the second lesson is that all the years of research, PBFT, Raft, Paxos, they all designed for the case of no adversarial behavior and very few participants. And so blindly applying them in 2018 at blockchains with 1,000 witnesses is, that could be a mistake. The second problem is query execution. Once you build a database that is sharded, there is no single node which has all the data. Each node has a subset of data. And there are simple cases that you can still easily execute. So I have an example here. There are 2 shards, one on the left, one on the right. And you can notice that the left shard has 2 tables, user and user orders. And those tables have data for the same subset of users. So both of them have data for users 1, 4, and 5. And on the right, I have shard 2. Again, user and user orders has data for the same set of users, 2, 3, and 6. So now if you want to run any query which joins user and user orders, that is trivial, because each particular shard can execute that node that query locally, and then you just aggregate a small response from every shard on a single machine. However, if you want to run a join which does not join data on the shard key, that becomes significantly more complex. At that point, it either requires a lot of communication between shards, or it requires redistributing data temporarily for the query to be fast. At that point, you will need some more sophisticated approaches, such as shuffle map or MapReduce. And as of today, as of 2018, there are a few analytical databases that support cross-shard joins, but there's practically no transactional database that would support them. Even though it's been more than 15 years of research and development, it's literally just Spark SQL, which is notoriously slow, and Spanner, which is built by an army of Google engineers and requires special hardware to run. There is no other transactional database which would support cross-shard joins. So on this optimistic note, let's talk about how would we shard blockchains. So today we have Ethereum. That's practically the only working blockchain that supports smart contracts. In Ethereum, every single transaction is executed on every single node that exists in the system. That effectively makes Ethereum single box. Right? It will never run faster than a single node can process transactions. And that also applies to all other existing blockchains, EOS. There's 21 nodes, but each of them has to process all the transactions still. Same applies to Neo. So how do we scale it? We can obviously shard it, but before we probably want to do something that is achievable short term. The first thing we can do is we can put memcached in front of it. So Ethereum develops a protocol called Plasma, which effectively says, let's put a very insecure blockchain in front of Ethereum, which, however, has security guarantees that you can securely transfer assets to that blockchain, and you can securely transfer assets from that blockchain back to Ethereum, even if the entire set of validators on that blockchain is malicious. That's a great way to scale Ethereum. It's achievable short term, so very likely we will have production-ready Plasma implementation until the end of this year. There are already a few of them ready as proof of concepts. And it does solve the practical problem, because ultimately, we're not expecting a lot of validators in Plasma to be malicious. So as long as they're not, it works very fast. And when they are, everybody can just transfer their assets out of Plasma, and nobody loses anything. The second thing we can do is we can move all the transactions to a single machine. And there are a few protocols which do that. I know two of them, Thunder and Solana. But the idea is that let's have one super expensive server which will process transactions super fast. And then I just design a protocol around that server that will guarantee that even if that server is operated by a malicious actor, the system is not compromised. In the very worst case, it will just resort to back to slower chain. Again, it's probably work in practice. We will see when they launch, and it is achievable short term. But in practice, at the end of the day, blockchain will not get mainstream adoption unless it is sharded. Right? That's why Ethereum is investing so heavily into sharding. That's why there are you will see multiple other protocols pitching sharding during this conference. And let's walk through how sharding could be built. If all we care about number of transactions we process per second, let's just shard processing. Let's just say that every node still maintains the entire state of the system, but only processes a subset of transactions. That is exactly what Zilliqa is doing. And there is one slight problem with sharding processing, which is shown on this chart. This chart shows the size of the Ethereum state. Not the history, not the entire blockchain, just the present state, the state that is relevant as of today. As of September, it was 100 gigabytes. And you can see that it grows linearly. And that is at 14 transactions per second. So if you want to have a blockchain which processes 100,000 transactions per second, it will not take long before your state could not possibly fit on any reasonable machine. So we don't need to shard state. Once we shard state, now effectively every node has a subset of state. Nobody has the entire state anymore. And without loss of generality, let's say that every node will process only transactions that affect the state that it has. And for simplicity, and that's what is proposed in every single protocol today, we will say that each particular smart contract belongs to some specific shard. So if you have CryptoKitties, they might live on shard 5. If you have IDEX, it might live on shard 4. And even though every transaction with CryptoKitties will be processed serially within the shard, they will not conflict with transactions from IDEX, right? So you still get bottlenecks per contract, but contracts do not fight with each other anymore for computing power. And a good example of someone who's building sharding state, besides obviously Near, is Ethereum 2.0. If you ever heard of Shasper, that's a good example. Now, the next step, this is not something that anyone proposed yet, but this is something that we would absolutely need to have if we want to have blockchain run all the mainstream applications, is sharding the smart contract state itself, right? Imagine a Twitter running as a smart contract. There's absolutely no chance that any particular machine would be able to store the entire state of the contract. So at that point, if that hypothetical Twitter scales, they will either have to shard their smart contract manually, meaning they would have to deploy multiple smart contracts on multiple shards and have some interoperability, or ideally the blockchain will just do that for them. It will just have a way for smart contracts to shard. And so now let's get a little bit, let's get back and see how sharding state is actually implemented today, or rather how it will be implemented soon. Let's go through Ethereum first. Right, so in Ethereum does not want to fork. Forking is terrible for any existing public blockchain. And so they're going to keep their existing proof of work chain. That's the one in yellow. However, the chain will be heavily offloaded. Barely any transaction will be processed there. The primary purpose of the chain will be for people to deposit 32 Ether to become a validator. And when they become a validator, now they can validate transactions in new blockchains, which will be launched. Most importantly, in shard chains. Every shard chain stores now the part of the state of Ethereum and has those validators validate transactions. And shard chains are proof of stake chains, so they're not burning trees. They're significantly faster. And every now and then, the problem is that every shard chain has only a subset of validators. That's a problem because because if you have 100 shards, every shard has only 1 over 100 of the validators. So the security is significantly less than if it was the entire validator pool validating the shard. And so what the solution is have a beacon chain. The beacon chain does not process transactions. All it does is it finalizes the transactions that happened in the shard chains. And the idea here is that the beacon chain has all the validators. It collects data from shards. And as long as it does not see any conflicting information, it uses Casper to create a Byzantine finality on the blocks. Our design is slightly simpler. We do not have any public chain running today. We don't have any legacy we have to keep. And so we have shard chains, which are very similar to Ethereum shard chains. And we have the main chain, which is somewhat similar to the beacon chain of Ethereum, with a major difference. The major difference is that shard chains do not communicate as often to the main chain. They have their own consensus protocol, which is more complex. And often shard chains can communicate with each other without going through the beacon chain. And we will get back to it in a couple minutes. But before that, let's address an elephant in the room. There's a huge problem with sharding state. If every shard is only responsible for a subset of data, and then let's say Alice on shard one wants to send money to Bob on shard two, there is a problem. Because nobody on shard one can process the transaction because they cannot add money to Bob's state, and nobody on shard two can process the transaction because they cannot take away money from Alice. So we do need to have some cross-shard communication. And if every shard is an independent blockchain, that would be as hard as having cross-chain communication, which is an open research problem today. And I will walk you through some proposals which are not mutually exclusive of how cross-shard transactions will be addressed in various chains, and then we will talk specifically about more interesting ideas there. So one approach we call single shard, that's what Zilliqa uses for smart contracts, is effectively it says, for as long as you have transactions that only affect the state of a single shard, execute them in parallel. And if you have transactions which affect the state of multiple shards, execute them serially. So the idea is that, let's say you have 100 transactions, each of which is only affecting one shard, then you have 5 transactions which affect 2 or more. Then you execute 100 transactions in parallel, effectively in 1/100th of a time, and then you execute 5 transactions serially, so you spend 6 time steps instead of having 105 time steps. So for as long as number of cross-shard transactions is very little compared to number of single-shard transactions, that is a great approach, right? The question is how achievable it is, or rather how realistic it is to assume that cross-shard transactions are rare. The second approach, which we internally call Beanstalk, says let's have no communication between shards. Let's have every single person have a count on every single shard. And if you want to send money to someone, you just send money on the shard on which you have sufficient funds. And if you don't have any shard where you have sufficient funds, you send on a subset of shards where you have sufficient funds in aggregate. In the worst case, you will have to send on every shard and have no parallelism. But in practice, most likely, for most cases, it will be a single shard transaction. And so you get all the benefits of parallelization with very little overhead and no cross-shard communication at all. It is most notably used by Flita, and they're not using it for smart contracts. They have a different proposal for smart contracts, but that's what they use for payments. Approach number three is proposed by Vitalik on ETH Research, and it says that, well, let's say that every now and then for every two shards, we have a merge block. A merge block is a synchronization point where two shards, using some smart fork choice rule, create two blocks which either both of them will be finalized at the end of the day or neither will be finalized. And so when you create those two blocks, the validators on both shards can somehow synchronize data from each other and execute any transaction which affects both states and then can be sure that both of them will ultimately happen. A continuation of that is what we built with Vlad 2 days ago. It's called correct by construction sharding. And the idea is it's very similar to merge blocks, but it's asynchronous. So a transaction initiates in one block, and it sends a message to another block, it initiates in a block in one shard. It sends a message to another shard. And that shard will either receive that message, and then once it receives the message, those blocks have, the fork choice rule will guarantee that those blocks are either both finalized or not. Or the shard will never receive the message, in which case the shard that initiated the message, the fork choice rule will abandon the block. So effectively, the idea is that ultimately, after many, many blocks, any cross-shard transaction is either fully finalized or fully orphaned. So the atomicity failure cannot be finalized, but there's no synchronization point. And the huge advantage of that is that in merge blocks, you have, first of all, you can only execute transactions which affect two shards, and otherwise you would have to have way more complex merge blocks affecting multiple. And second of all, if you have 100 shards, you have 10,000 pairs of shards, meaning that you would have to create those merge blocks quite frequently, and that is not possible to do. So those merge blocks would be super, super rare. If you want to learn more about how CBC works, you can go to bit.ly CBC sharding. Finally, the last proposal, and again, as I said, they're not mutually exclusive, is receipts. The idea of receipts is, I have this figure on the bottom. If Alice wants to send money to Bob, then first the shard which has Alice confirms that she has money. It debits the account, and it sends some sort of receipt to the Bob's account. Right. So as I said, the ideas are not mutually exclusive. For CBC sharding to work, receipts have to be a primitive that is implemented. The idea. So what is the receipt? The receipt could be, for example, some way of proving that the block exists and finalized in the shard with a given Merkle root and the Merkle path to the transaction, which does the work. Or if we use some sort of Byzantine consensus, a receipt could be just a multi-signature of Byzantine majority of validators in the shard. Anything that would securely prove to shard one that the transaction did happen, that Alice's account wasn't indeed debited, and that it is safe to proceed. So now with that, that is effectively a quick overview of the present, or what is probably going to happen very soon. Now let's talk about the future, and specifically, in the bright future of humanity, on my phone, I would not have anything that tracks me, that sends my data to any third parties. Ideally, everything will run on blockchain. I would like to have my social network to run on blockchain. I would like my ride-sharing app to run on blockchain so that I can validate whatever the code I'm running on my phone and what is executed on the server. For that, we would have to have sharding of smart contracts. And so let's talk about how that will be built, how that can work. And as an example, I will be using a ride-sharing app. Let's say we building some sort of blockchain Lyft. And let's say you want to call a cab. We cannot possibly, in order to find the closest car to you, go through every single car and see how far it is from you. We'd have to have some sort of indexing. We have to have some sort of way to quickly identify the cars which are potentially close to you. And the way to do that is to effectively, we would put some grid on the world. So let's say we're just building it for San Francisco. So we would separate San Francisco into sort of squares or some locations, smaller locations, and we will just index on those locations. So here on the left, I have a figure where I have a square city separated into four smaller locations, purple, green, blue, and orange. And there are two cars in the green and the blue location. There's a person in the pink location. All right, and so we have three entities. We have cars, and cars are naturally sharded by car ID. So if we have, let's say, 200 cars, we can say 100 of them, IDs 1 to 100, will live on one shard, and the remaining ones will live on the second shard. Similarly, users live on two shards. They're separated by user ID, and location somehow sharded by location. Importantly, there is no way to guarantee that if a user is calling a cab, the closest cab will be on the same shard as them. Because cars are moving, users are moving, there's no way to keep users from one shard close to the cars from the same shard. And also there's no way to make sure that the users on shard one only appear on locations from shard one. And so let's say that the car is moving. So the car was in the blue location, now it moves to the pink location. We would probably want to update the index. We would want to say that on the shard with the blue location, we want to remove the car, and on the shard with the pink location, we would want to edit so that people can quickly access it. And so we could have some function, so I have it written here. Importantly, it tries to access the car by the car ID and location by location ID. The problem is those could be on two different shards. So the first line of this method and the second line could easily have to access data which does not reside on any single machine. It's a big problem for two reasons. First, it's very hard to design runtimes for existing languages that will support such sort of execution. And second of all, it's a problem for the developer. The developer could accidentally introduce a cross-shard communication into their contract, which is expensive, without even like realizing the fact that this happened. But first, let's see how logically that smart contract would be executed to begin with. So the car is moving. The first thing we need to do is we need to read its location. The location is only stored on the shard where the car is residing. So it starts on shard one. And location is blue. The blue location is on shard two. So we're sending a receipt with the proof that the location is correct, where the location is where the car is deleted from the shard. Then it sends it further to the shard with the pink location where it is inserted. And finally, that doesn't have to be cross-shard communication. It's the same shard. The car gets updated. So if you look at this code, there is a way to change the runtime and do it with any existing language which supports reflection in a way that it becomes, first, it's super easy to build such a runtime, and second of all, very clear for developer what's happening, and that's called tail calls, or in the search community, it's also called continuation passing. And the idea is that every function can only touch one shard, and then you can invoke another function, but you can only do that as a very last instruction of your function. And the reason for that is that if it's a very last instruction, you don't have to keep the current function on the stack. Right? If you call a function and there's something else after that, you have to store the state of the present function. You put it on the stack, you call some other function, it executes, then as you go back, you recover the state from the stack. If it's a tail call, you don't have to do that because the function that is calling on the calling side, it is done. So there's no state to be recovered. And so with tail calls, it's super trivial to build the runtime which will execute those functions. And for the developer, it is absolutely clear where they're having a cross-shard communication because they intentionally put a tail call in those places. Now let's think how that would be built in Ethereum. So let's say that on shard one, we start some cross-shard communication. First of all, in order for that to have a proof that that communication actually is, the transaction is finalized, we would have to go to beacon chain and have one iteration of Casper to finalize. And then after that, the shard that has the next hop needs to pull that state, pull the receipt, and make the next step. There are some proposals to speed it up, but that is effectively how that would have to be built today. And the problem here is that, first of all, blocks are published every 8 seconds. And second of all, the Casper finality is also not instantaneous. It's a Byzantine consensus protocol. So here we're looking at easily between 20 to 30 to 40 seconds per one hop. Right? So you have three hops or four, that's multi-minute transaction execution. If you're just calling a cab, that is prohibitively expensive. We want something significantly faster. So we're actively researching how to make receipts faster. We have an algorithm we developed called TXSlow. We just recently published a write-up on it. If you're interested, it's bit.ly/TXSlow/consensus. I'm not going to talk too much about it, but in very short, effectively what it means is that we run some sort of a Byzantine consensus algorithm. It doesn't have all the guarantees of the Byzantine consensus algorithm. That would be too expensive. In every shard, and because of that, we can bypass the main chain, and so shard can communicate with each other very frequently and publish blocks more often than every 8 seconds. There is no dependency on the real time, and so the moment the consensus is ready, the block gets published, and that can bring it to between 1 and 3 seconds per hop. Now let's talk a little bit about parallelism, right? So in the previous example I was showing, even though the transaction was cross-shard, at no point it was executing anything in parallel. At every given timestamp, the execution was on some particular shard. Sometimes it would be very desirable to get some parallelism. So let's say the person in the pink location wants to call a cab. Even though we know they're in the pink location, they might be at the very boundary of it. So the closest card could easily be on one of the neighboring locations. It could be in the green location or a blue location. And so it would make sense to search for the closest car in all the neighboring locations, then aggregate them. Right, and so there's a technique for that called scatter collect, which is a It's a particular case of a MapReduce framework, which simplifies it significantly. The idea is that we start by reading location on shard 2 where the user is located. And so we know it's a pink location, we know the neighboring locations, and we send the receipts to all the shards of the neighboring locations. And that is obviously trivial. There's no major difference between sending single receipt and sending multiple receipts. And in every location, there's a the function is executed, it finds the closest car, and then they all send back to shard 2 for the aggregation. So the aggregation step is the step that is tricky, because once you receive the first receipt, you cannot really proceed yet. So first of all, you need some way to accumulate the receipts. And second of all, you need to know exactly how many receipts to wait for. And so scatter collect simplifies it by saying that the number of receipts is always going to be equal to the number of steps we actually execute. So if scatter sent 4 execution requests, then collect will have to receive 4 receipts. And that's a huge simplification, which helps a lot with aggregation, and already enables a lot of use cases. Now, when we look at this, one question we should ask ourselves: this is effectively multi-processing execution, which is super prone to all sorts of race conditions. What happens if the car just moved out from the location? What if it just moved in? What if it just went offline? What if the user, as if it was calling the function, moved to a different location? So ideally, we'd have some concurrency control in place. There is decades of research in concurrency control. There are pessimistic concurrency control, which is often implemented in most of the database, optimistic concurrency control. There are some heuristics. If any of you know VolDB, VolDB is particularly famous for building a lot of heuristics for concurrency control. A particular problem which people often use as an example is a train and hotel problem, where the idea is that you have a train on one shard and a hotel on another shard, and you either want to book both of them or neither. And so in a way, you need to block the hotel for the time that it takes you to book a train. That would be pessimistic control. Or you would have to try to book both of them, and then right before you commit to verify they're still both available, that would be optimistic concurrency control. There's one proposal that we plan to implement in our protocol, again by Vitalik. It's called yanking. It is very close to pessimistic control. You're locking the entity. So in this case, if we want to first book the train and then the hotel, we would lock the train. But together with that, we will also send it to the shard of the hotel. So for as long as it is locked, it also resides on a different shard. And why it helps is that now you can do the entire processing of the booking on a single shard. So if we need any other communication, now we don't have to do it. At this point, all the entities we care about are on the same shard, so that becomes a single shard transaction. And I guess the last interesting topic I want to touch on is that hopefully in the bright future, we will not have to limit ourselves to scatter collect. We would implement the more general MapReduce framework. The challenges of the MapReduce framework is, so that is an example of how the MapReduce job could look on the sharded blockchain. There's an entry point where the transaction starts. It executes 3 more processes. They execute a few more. And at that point, there is 5. And there is not a single entity in the network that knows there is 5 of them. And then they call a reduce. And reduce goes to multiple shards. And there is 1 shard with 3 receipts, 1 with 2. The problem is, how do we know how many receipts to wait for? And so that becomes more complex. We need some sort of orchestrator which will be orchestrating the job. But that will be, with all of those techniques we discussed today, we will probably be able to go to the bright future of blockchains. As of today, we're not building any of the cross-shard contracts into our initial release. At the beginning, we're optimizing for, there's no use cases for that yet anyway. The most used contracts today, IDEX, CryptoKitties, and a few others, have like barely thousands of daily active users. So we're nowhere close yet to needing any of that. That's all bright future. Today, with proof of stake and state sharding, importantly, what we can enable is we can enable low-end devices, because you don't have to store huge state. You don't have to burn CPU on proof of work. And you can actually, with proper engineering, run blockchain on laptops or even on the mobile phones. And potentially, that will enable millions of devices operating the network, which significantly increases the scalability and security of the network. And so that is the key to the decentralized Web3 future. So if you like any of that, please follow us. We're also hosting a few events coming. Today, we have a developer workshop at 3:30 p.m., where we'll be covering a lot of the future we were discussing today. We will be building some smart sharded smart contracts. We have an ABC sharding panel today at 6:30 with a harmonic quark and multivac. And finally, on Thursday, we're hosting a sharding panel with Ethereum Foundation and a few companies building Ethereum sharding. So that would be super interesting. Please join us.